Hello everyone, welcome to Humane Architecture here on ThinkTech Hawaii. I am the co-host of this program, DeSoto Brown. I am the historian at Fisher Museum. And for me, it's 4 o'clock in the afternoon, but in Germany, unfortunately, it's 4 o'clock in the morning, and joining us from Germany via Skype is the host of this program, who is Martin Despang. And good morning to you, Martin, and welcome.
Good morning, DeSoto and everyone. Look forward to the show. What is it about?
Okay, well, we're going to be talking about Blaisdell Center here in Honolulu, and you can see Martin on the screen with me. And the Blaisdell Center goes back to the 1960s, and it is currently under discussion for redevelopment. We're going to be talking about that towards the end of the program, but let's get started on photograph number one to show people what we're talking about.
Yeah, that goes back to a little tradition we have from some shows ago where we try to encourage people to put their mind back in certain zeitgeist
eras,
using a German word again. Yes. And this is DeSoto again, some few years ago.
This is the sign at the Blaisdell Center as it is looked in the 1960s, the 1980s. And if you look on the left, there's a young DeSoto Brown with dyed blonde hair, posing with a poster for the Devo concert that was about to happen. And in the lower right corner of the screen, you see DeSoto Brown many years later meeting Mark Mothersbaugh, who was the lead singer of the group Devo, and getting his autograph and getting my picture taken with him. So it all comes back around, as it always does. And the Blaisdell Center has been the host of all kinds of different programs over the years since it opened in 1964. And I saw Devo there, but everybody else has seen all kinds of other things there as well. And it's served a very important purpose in the city of Honolulu.
So if we go to picture two, we see someone who's almost as famous as you and Devo, which is this gentleman here, Mr. Elvis Presley. And you told me that before the Blaisdell was built, there was no venue that could host shows of that caliber, right?
Correct.
So the Blaisdell being built then enabled this particular show, which is Elvis from Hawaii, which became the largest at that time broadcasted via satellite event. So very, very, very important, very, very famous, put our little tiny spots island chain on the world map of world broadcasting, right?
Right. And that was 1973, and there is the statue of Elvis at the Blaisdell Center today that commemorates this concert, which, as you said, was an international event back when it happened in 1973.
Mm-hmm. And it's standing close to the ticket booth, and we can get picture three. This is just to get people an idea who aren't around how the Blaisdell looks right now. And this one is particularly the big arena where these big concerts happen. But before we dive in deeper, let's take a look at picture number four, which gives an idea how the site looked like before all that.
Yeah. And this was a private home. This was a home of a family called the Wards, which is why Ward Avenue is one of the boundaries of the Blaisdell Center. And on this Ward property, there were natural springs and naturally fed ponds, which were there, as well as a whole host of coconut trees and other types of trees. And gradually, Honolulu urbanized around the site. And then in 1958, when the last member of the family died, the city and county of Honolulu purchased the property specifically to develop into the complex which became today's Blaisdell Center.
And that's what we see on picture number five, where it all got drained and dredged and the palm trees cut down, leading to picture number six, which is the condition in 1964,
right,
where you can see that the area is comprised of, in the front of the picture, that arena. In the middle is the exhibit hall, and at the very end, towards that park, Mauka side, is the concert hall.
And a little bit of parking on the far right side. And today, of course, there's a parking building there. Originally, it was just one big flat parking lot. And that's going to play into what we're going to be discussing later on in the program.
Exactly. And for that, we need to visualize the current condition, which is the next picture, number 7, which shows looking at the complex, seeing the arena in the distance in the back, and seeing the exhibit hall in the middle ground. And you can see that there has been some adding on to the exhibit hall, I believe, in the early 90s, which both as far as the narrowing the public space between Ward Avenue, which you mentioned, and that one was compromised. And we also, I think it's fair to say, was architecturally compromised, because our permanent background picture, actually, that you guys see when we don't have any particular other picture in there, is showing the exhibit hall in its original condition. And you talked about that public workshop, DeSoto, and can we get picture number 8? Our show is very timely, because that first workshop that was held by the city was in February 2015. So now we're 2.5 years later, and workshop number 2 is actually happening in 2 days. So people, please go and engage. And today's show is, so to speak, food for thought, for preparing you to reflect and have an opinion of whatever kind in that workshop. And number 8 basically shows a proposal, and I hope that I read the online available material right, that this is what the city basically suggests after having consulted all the experts and the public, which is pretty much sort of returning to the roots of emphasizing the public outdoor space. You can see all that green in here, and you can see that the arena and the concert hall are suggested to be kept, while the exhibit hall is supposed to be replaced by some kind of structure. But basically, the main message that makes me happy is you see a lot of green, so that emphasizing that outdoor space is something that the city is suggesting. So in number 10, let's see the concert hall. This picture I took a few while ago while looking at Malka, and you see the park across the street. And I'm standing in front of the building, or in the building, which is that big open lanai where, when we go to the next picture, number 11, that big roof overhang with that waffle slab structure is becoming that big celebratorial space that, especially at night, through the illumination, really lights up and has a very glorious celebratory effect. And I pulled this picture, number 11, from a peer review by the Monocle magazine, which is an internationally recognized magazine that also publishes these tour guides, city guides. And at the very top left, you can see which of the metropolises in the world, a selection of them, they consider to be worthwhile to be featured. And guess what? They also consider our metropolis of Honolulu one. And they make a major point, a major part of that whole point is mid-century modern. And relative to that, they pick the Blaisdell Center as a prime piece that they think is so cool that they feature it. So lots of culturally interested tourists in the world, you know, have an expectation when they go to Honolulu, and they want to see these jewels. This is, by the way, one of the reasons we named the show after that.
Right. And
so
your point was that there are...
So if we go to picture number 12, what do we see there, DeSoto?
Well, I was going to say that this is one of the three jewels that we're talking about that comprise the Blaisdell Center, the concert hall, the meeting area, and the arena. And this, as you've pointed out, is this amazing screen, which is a metal, custom-made metal screen. And in each one of those open spaces, there is a custom-cut piece of kind of amber textured glass which fits in, and yet it leaves open space so that there's air movement. And one of the things that you and I were talking about is that this is an art piece of itself, which you could not replicate today because of the expense that's involved. So whatever is going to be happening to the Blaisdell, one of the things that needs to be kept in mind is this in particular must not be done away with or demolished or altered tremendously because of its uniqueness and irreplaceableness.
Exactly. And that's a recommendation or suggestion we would have if someone would ask us, is that while the suggestion is right to keep Jewel's the arena and keep the other Jewel the concert hall, which we're seeing here. There were some suggestions in the text of the current document online that suggests to update these facilities, which is understandable. You got to go with the time, but as you said, you better return to the roots, what what it was about at the very beginning. And again, number 12, what we're looking at the picture is once again the monocle series. Who recognized that screen as something so cool that people from all over the world should travel there and check it out. And right. The top picture is from the monocle, the bottom picture are pictures that I took from that thing. And as you said, this metal grill that is so delicate, and then these hand-cut chevron-like glass pieces, they have been glued in there by hand. And everyone who builds a building in Honolulu knows if you spend like millions of hours building something, you spend millions of dollars. And that is the reason why this jewel in particular, this micro jewel within the bigger macro jewel, is not buildable in these days anymore, because we're talking public project, we're talking public funding. Let's move to the next picture, number 13, which shows the third jewel, which is the arena itself. And the same applies to arena. The arena is a jewel. You can even say formally it's a jewel because it has kind of a diamond shaped as a macro form. Well, when you go to the detail, which is number 14, you see that sort of polishing of that diamond is also true to the very detail.
Right. And something I also want to point out too is that because the parts of these buildings are surrounded by water that's below level, you get not only a reflection of the water during the day that illuminates the building from underneath, but at night you get the reflection of the illuminated building in the water. And the water adds a great deal to the entire experience. And the water is an homage, if you will, to the water features that used to exist on the property that we showed you a photo of at the beginning of the program. So this is not just decorative, it actually is a historical reference to what used to be there.
Exactly. So it's a performative feature, right? It also performs climatically, by the way, because only in our privileged tropics, evaporative cooling is possible.
Right.
So you make the thermal comfort of the concert guests better. And as you said, water is actually less a landscape arc element here. It's actually an architectural element.
Correct.
And so is the refinement of the architecture that gets reflected, like this column. I mean, think about columns the day event typologies are built today. They're built the cheapest way. They're built with round columns or square columns. This sort of trapezoid shape, sectional shape of the column is close to impossible today, given the fact of how highly capitalized and profit-based these typologies are. So Blaisdell Center is unique because this was culturally approached and money really didn't matter as much as it does today.
And also,
so congratulations again to the city to seem to have recognized that, and we encourage the city to follow through with that through all the detailing. So whenever you retrofit, which you have to, which we understand, you can do that in a hidden way. There's so many historic buildings which have to be updated. I remember IIT by Mies van der Rohe in Chicago, where Crook and Sexton have replaced the single pane glass with double or triple pane,
right,
so that you don't see that. So things like that are actually possible.
Correct. And something you pointed out too is that this goes along with the show that we just did about kooky canopies that are probably irreplaceable today just because of the engineering that's involved. The jagged roof line and the the underneath part of this is sort of a zigzag too, and this is something that wouldn't be done today, and it needs to be preserved because it's so much of its time and because nobody would build it that way today.
Exactly. So then that gives us the focus on the third jewel that actually the city seems to think to has to be replaced. So let's go to number 15, and that's the exhibit hall. This is a picture which shows the transition between the arena and the exhibit hall. And returning to our last show, which you just said, is this idea of having nature intertwined with architecture. Here's still some palm trees going through the roof, which isn't so much the case anymore. And number 16 is a picture of the current situation of the exhibit hall, looking at it from the Diamond Head site, which, shame on me, and I've been a visitor of some shows there, I have never seen that pond, which is partly blamed on what has happened over the years, where you can see there's a solid wall. And that solid wall had not been there originally. If we go to the next picture, this is a picture you provided to DeSoto, which shows it in its original use and occupation, right?
Yes. So this is a picture from the late 1960s inside the exhibit hall. It was, interestingly, a luau for Mayor Neil Blaisdell, for whom the complex is now named. It was originally called the Honolulu International Center, and the name was changed in the 1980s. But originally, that wall, the walls were mostly open. There were vertical louvers, there were open spaces underneath that zigzag ceiling. And then in the center of the ceiling, in the center of the roof, there were these raised portions which had an open space around them. So you were getting entirely natural air movement, not only through the walls, but also through these open spaces in the ceiling and the roof.
Mm-hmm. And the next picture you provided as well, I think from your eyewitness position, right?
Absolutely.
There was a car show in there, which has now moved to the convention center.
Correct.
And in this picture, people can see what you just described. However, here, these two big openings in the roof, which remind me of clearings in the forest, had already been covered. But at least there was some gap between the original roof and the new roof, so air could go through.
Correct.
And, you know, you could get some light in there.
Correct.
And so if you replace that that jewel, because when I was in there and was showing the age home at the BIA show, I was noticing these very delicate, also going back to our last show, mushroom type pillars and roofs, almost like little umbrellas. They're very delicate, and they don't make that much sense anymore because their context, the easy breezy context, and then being standing alone like umbrellas that you find shelter underneath from rain and the sun has been altered, has been destroyed pretty much. So we're saying using picture number 19 is another picture you were digging out, DeSoto, right?
Picture 19, that's an old picture that's an artistic view from the 1960s of what this used to look like, as if you were looking at it from Thomas Square. And one of the things that you pointed out was the view from the concert hall across King Street to Thomas Square is part of also the experience. And even though King Street is a very busy street, if you look across to the greenery of Thomas Square, you're not really that aware of the street. You have this extended view as part of your experience of attending the concert there. And that's what's really important. And I can see that in the plan at the upper part of this slide that we're showing right now, that continuation and that view towards Thomas Square still remains something that they are thinking about. And that's implied in this, which I think is extremely important. And I'm glad that somebody's got that awareness.
Yeah, yeah. So it's in compliance with the original intent, as you said, this artist rendering or architect rendering that was not, by the way, a computer rendering, because computers didn't exist at that time to do this stuff. They existed, but not to do high-end photorealistic renderings.
By no means.
This is a very suggestive illustration. And the suggestion is, you know, this is still paradise, right? This is still tropical. There's still palm trees. And these jewels are, so there's these nice, you know, little pieces of jewelry that are nestled in this sort
Correct.
Of paradisal nature.
And some of those original trees, are original to the site. I think were originally planted there. They did not keep all of them, but they did keep some of those original coconut palms, which are still standing today.
Absolutely. So when we were thinking about that, okay, this is the challenge now. The whole area has to be updated and to be brought up to the expectations of modern entertainment industry. So, and times have changed. So there's significant change happening. So how can you, you know, make that possible while not bastardizing, compromising the original master plan idea, meaning the experience of people not being in Minneapolis, not being in New York City, being in Honolulu, Hawaii, where outdoors is possible all year round. And I was, you know, reflecting on that while thinking about a project we have done some years ago, which is the next picture. And the top picture is left, and the picture on the right shows where we were asked to do a kindergarten in Germany's oldest university in Göttingen, and to integrate it into the campus, into the Arboretum campus, the greenery of the campus. And we said, we don't want to build there. So we decided to put the building not underground, but berm the building, put dirt over it and next to it, so you kind of camouflage the building. And a more prominent example of that strategy is our colleague Snow Hedda's Oslo Opera House, which you can see at the very bottom left, which they said, you know, there are people who can't afford to buy a ticket, so make the opera an inclusive event. And they suggested to celebrate the fifth facade, which is the roof, and they make the roof accessible. And we'll never forget when Craig Digeris was visiting us at my times in Nebraska, and in he was in his lecture, he was pulling a YouTube video that was showing a guy on a cross motorcycle driving it on the edge of that roof and police chasing him. And he saw that as the proof of evidence for the success of his design, that the public was able to engage the building. But again, that's like, you know, not probably literally applicable to our situation. But another event, which is the next picture, I was able to attend here. This is in historic Dresden, and VW was able to convince the city to build a clean glazed factory in downtown Dresden next to the most historic parks and one big open gathering space, which you can see here. I was attending with my family here a concert of where Placido Domingo was the conductor, in that case, a fabulous event. And the architecture, the modern, clear architecture became the backdrop, the background. And next picture, number 22, one of the pieces of architecture is actually a car storage tower. This very round cylindric building is actually a building where they store their cars, the cars they have just, you know, recently made. They display them, and then there's a robot arm that you know, takes them out and brings them down and delivers them to the customer. And the little picture to the right is a tower we've been able to do many years ago when the smart car was first introduced to Germany, where it comes from. We had these similar automated parking garages. And a very dear friend of mine, of ours, who passed away a couple of years ago, unfortunately, had always been the biggest fan of these automated parking towers. So Erhard, thanks for that inspiration and bringing this back. We allowed ourselves on the next picture, number 23, to make a I think you called it a suggestion in the last show, so you already made a promise to the audience. And this is us suggesting to say, hey, what if you bring all these new necessary functions into this sort of backbone service building? It's this big bar in the back. And you can see these round scribbled in circles. This is the suggested parking cylinders, because then you can park so much more efficiently and effectively. Without having to have the traffic back up and jam, right? Yeah. And so why don't you do that? And through that, you can basically free the exhibit hall from
I think we just lost Martin. What Martin has been saying is that this backbone structure that he's proposing would be for two reasons. One, for parking. And he points out that you can do this through this automated parking system, which has been done in Honolulu before. The Honolulu, there you got it back. The Aloha Motors Chevrolet car dealership used a large automated parking garage in the 1960s. And there's also a small one that's been functioning for many years in McCully. I assume it's still there. And something else that Martin said would be to use this structure to project upon, so that it isn't just one big concrete thing, but to use that surface as something that you could project images onto, so that if you aren't actually attending a concert, outside you can see stuff that's projected on the building. And I think that Honolulu is really losing out on not using our structures more for nighttime illumination, for drama, for interest, for entertainment. And that's what this new structure, which would take the place of the current parking structures at the Blaisdell Center, might be worth investigating. And so I think that's something that really should be talked about. And it's a combination of using new technology for parking cars, in which you don't need the space that are required for ramps. And as Martin said, it can be done a lot more efficiently so that you don't have a big traffic backup going out onto King Street and blocking traffic. And the building can be used for different types of uses, et cetera. So I think that's
absolutely
a good suggestion. There you are. Are you back, Martin?
I'm back.
Okay, good.
And if you get picture number 24 here, this illustrates what you were just talking about, is that while the structure would be new, but its inspiration is of local kind, not only have these automated parking systems exhibited at this Chevrolet dealer, but also this facade could be a louvered facade. And these louvers would shade the building from the west side, would keep it cool, but also these louvers could be the projection screen. There's LED versions of that. And as you pointed out, and this traces back to one of our very first shows, which was the Alamoana building, which was super innovative at the very top left. It had these louvers. So there's island tradition that you could relate to even architecturally. But once again, this building is first and foremost, you know, functionally comprising all the extra functions you need. But then more importantly, it becomes the backdrop, almost the stage curtain for these jewels we're talking about. And
correct,
we're getting towards the end of the show. So maybe we get number 25, which is actually our permanent background show, that through that you could bring back that third jewel, which is the exhibit hall, which I think is a marvelous building. It's this pavilion, this outdoor pavilion with these breeze blocks, easy breezy screens. This is paradise. This is tropical. And this is what people might want to embrace more these days than in the 90s, when the exhibit hall was pretty much under the zeitgeist of the 90s. Air conditioning was big, indoors was big. And I believe we luckily overcame these days, and we're maybe ready to reconnect to the easy breezy original.
Well, if we're lucky, we will get there.
All right, sounds good.
Okay, well, that brings us to the end of another Humane Architecture episode on ThinkTech Hawaii. That was Martin Despang, the host of the program, and I am DeSoto Brown, the co-host. And we will be joining you again 2 weeks from now for another episode of Humane Architecture. So until then, everyone, aloha.